Vsauce, Kevin here, and I have a simple coin flipping game that requires no skill, has no catch or trick, and can lead to infinite wealth. The thing is, nobody really wants to play it. Why? How is it possible that an incredibly easy game with infinite upside causes virtually everyone to react with a massive yawn? To play this game, we'll turn to the most rational, calculating man in history, longtime friend of Vsauce 2,
Vsauce!
Dwight Schrute. You walk up to the table to flip a coin. Your prize starts at $2. If the coin flip results in false, the game is over and you win $2. If it lands on fact, you play another round and your prize doubles. Every time you get a fact, you keep playing and the prize keeps doubling. From $2 to $4 to $8, $16, $32, $64, $128, so on and so on forever. But as soon as you get a false, you are done and you collect your winnings. So if you hit a false in the third round, then your prize is $8. If your false comes in round 14, you'd walk away with $16,384. No matter how unlucky you are, you'll never win less than $2. If things go really well, then things go really well. Now that you know the potential payoffs, how much would you be willing to pay to play this game? $3? What about $20? $100? The winnings could be infinite. So the question is, how much is a chance at infinite wealth worth to you? We can determine the precise answer, but first, we need to know the game's expected value, which is the sum of all its possible outcomes relative to their probability. That determines the point at which we choose to play a game. Or in the real world, the point at which we decide to take out insurance on our house or a life insurance policy. If our risk is less than our likely reward, we should play. If we're paying too much relative to what we're likely to get out of playing, then we should not play. Here's the expected value of Schrute. You've got a 50-50 chance of losing on your first flip and heading back to the beet farm with $2. With a probability of 1/2 and a payoff of $2, your expected value in the first round is $1. The probability of winning two rounds is 1/2 times 1/2, or 1/4. And your prize there would be $4. That's another $1 in expected value. For three successful flips, it's 1/2 raised to the third power, or 1/8, times the $8 prize, another dollar. 1/16 times 16, 1/32 times 32, 1/64 times 64, etc., etc., etc. For n rounds, the expected value is the probability 1/2 to the nth power times the payoff of 2 to the nth power. So no matter the value of n, the result will be 1. The expected value of the game is 1 plus 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 1 forever. Because each round adds $1 of value no matter how rare the occurrence might be. The expected value is infinite. And there's our paradox, because you'd think a rational person would pay all the money they have to play this game. Mathematically, it makes sense to pay any amount of money less than infinity to play. No matter what amount of money you risk, you're theoretically getting the deal of a lifetime. The reward justifies the risk, but nobody wants to do that. Who would empty their bank account to play a game where they know there's a 75% chance that they walk away with $4 or less? It's confusing because expected value is mathematically how you determine whether you'll play a game. Look, if I offered you a coin flipping game where you won $5 on heads and lost $1 on tails, your expected value of each round would be the sum of those possible outcomes. 50% chance times winning $5, plus 50% chance times losing $1. Half the time you'll win $5 and half the time you'll lose $1. In the long run, you'll average plus $2 for every round you play, so paying anything under $2 to play that game would be a great deal. When the price to play is less than your expected value, it's a no-brainer. And since the expected value of the Shroot game is infinite, paying anything less than infinite money to play it should also be a no-brainer. But it's not. Why? The thing that's so interesting about this game is how the math conflicts with actual humans. Enter prospect theory, an element of cognitive psychology in which people make choices based on the value of wins and losses instead of just theoretical outcomes. The reason people don't want to empty their pockets to play this game, despite its infinite gains, is that the expected marginal utility, its actual value to them, goes down as those mathematical gains increase forever. This solution was discovered a few years ago. A few hundred years ago. In 1738, Daniel Bernoulli published his exposition of a new theory on the measurement of risk in the Commentaries of the Imperial Academy of Science of St. Petersburg, and what we now call the St. Petersburg Paradox was born. Bernoulli didn't dispute the expected value of the St. Petersburg game. Those are cold, hard numbers. He just realized there was a lot more to it. Bernoulli introduced the concept of the expected utility of a game, what was until the 20th century called moral expectation to differentiate it from mathematical expectation. The main point of Bernoulli's resolution was that utility, or how much a thing matters to you, is relative to an individual's wealth, and that each unit tends to be worth a little less to you as you accumulate it. So, as an example, not only would winning $1,000 mean a lot more to someone who's broke than it would to, say, Tony Stark, but even winning $1 million wouldn't affect the research and development at Stark Industries. And there's also a limit on a player's comfort with risk, with John Maynard Keynes arguing that a high relative risk is enough to keep a player from engaging in a game even with infinite expected value. Iron Man can afford to lose a few billion. You probably can't. And value itself is subjective. If I won 1,000 peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, I would be thrilled. If someone allergic to peanuts won them, they would be less thrilled. So, okay. Given all this, how much can you afford to lose in the St. Petersburg game? How badly do you want to play? Bernoulli used the logarithmic function to come up with price points that factored in not only the expected value of the game, but also the wealth of the player and its expected utility. A millionaire should be comfortable paying as much as $20.88 to flip Shroots, while someone with $1,000 would top out at $10.95. Someone with a total of $2 of wealth should, according to the logarithmic function, borrow $1.35 from a friend to pay $3.35. Ultimately, everyone has their own price that factors in their wealth, their desires, their comfort with risk, their preferences, how they want to spend their time, what else they could be doing with their money, their own happiness, and the thing is, this game can't even exist. Economist Paul Samuelson points out that a game of potentially infinite gain requires the other party to be comfortable with potentially infinite loss, and no one is cool with that. So, if the important elements are variable and the game can't exist, what's the point? The St. Petersburg Paradox reminds us that we're all more than math. The raw numbers might convince a robot that it's a good idea to wager its robo house on a series of coin flips, but you know, deep down, that's a really bad idea. Because You aren't an expected value calculation. You aren't a logarithmic function. The numbers are a part of you and help you live your life, but in the end, you are you. Fact. And as always, thanks for watching.